it to be hanging out with some birds.
Squatter's house for
well,
you.
Well, I think the whole thing that's interesting for me is, like, you think about real life. Think about, like, you know, you come into a certain room, if it's very clean, you kind of, you know, whoever you're around, you know, sometimes you sit like that. Sometimes you sit like this. Sometimes, you know, you're so affected by your surroundings, even down to the sunshine in the morning. If you wake up in LA and it's raining, how different is your day? You know, so I think when you're thrown into a world that is, I'm from the southwest of England, going to the Salton Sea was fucking mind-blowing. But at the same time, it was one of the most beautiful places I've ever been to in my life, and I had this extraordinary day where we were actually down on the beach, and I had to roll around on
fish boat
sand. Yeah, and you sit up and you have just a fish carcass in your hair. And there's something kind of, you know, if you think about it, it's kind of amazing. How many people here have had a fish carcass in their hair? You know, it's kind of like, but that was their fun. And I'm sure as little kids, they would pick up fish bones and be like, hi, you want to go play games? You know, it's about figuring out what you're given. And we had this extraordinary moment there where we were filming the exterior of one of the shots outside this trailer. And this family came out, and two people came out first, and then another four, and then another two. And you sit there and you watch this, and you're like, this is unreal. That this is their, like, all of them are living in this small space, and they're making it work together, because they were smiling.
Yeah,
they were fucking happy, you know? And that's so, and that was the thing with us. My character's frustrated by where she is. She needs something bigger, she needs something brighter, she wants light, she wants noise, she wants experience, she wants something else. But she, it's the thing, she doesn't know what it is. But I think, you know, also, yeah, the Salton Sea, getting to go there first was amazing because it looks like World War III has happened there. But it is so beautiful at the same time. It's this destruction that is...
The sky was always so
extraordinary, and the water is a coppery, blood red color, and it's just... But you have to get used to the smell. There's this sulfur smell that you kind of, when you first get, oh, wow. But then you get used to it after a day of it. You're like, oh, yeah, it's potent.
The Los Angeles that the girls might have envisioned in their mind is a little different than the Los Angeles that they end up in. For all three of you, do you remember the impressions that you had in your mind of Los Angeles before you came here, and then how it compared to your first experience?
For me, being from Boston, and it's always like you want to run away to California, run away to the West Coast, you know, and you dream it. And I didn't understand that Los Angeles and the beach were actually so far from each other. I thought the beach was just right there. But then moving here, I actually moved to Silver Lake, thank God, which is where I live now, and I love that area. But that's why we filmed everything there, because that's all I knew. So I just wrote what was outside, and that's usually in LA you don't see. And that's why we're very careful not to show, like, Pink's hot dogs and all those kinds of scene films. And even when we're going through, may not be that cinematic, but when the girls first come here, you're still looking through a bug, you know, splattered windshield, and it's dirty and it's grimy, and you're just looking at really, like, ugly strip of Sunset Boulevard, because that's
the
way LA is.
It looks uglier than the Salton Sea in the movie.
Yeah, totally. And that's
what
we wanted to
do,
because the Salton Sea is home, so we're going to shoot all those warm colors, so it felt like home, you know?
When you came
to Juno Temple Kay Panabaker, maybe give your first impression of Los Angeles.
I mean, I'm a little tainted. My parents lived out here for about 12 years, so I had spent my first 5 years living on Orange Grove just off Sunset. So that's a little tainted vision of LA. But when I came out here on my own, I lived in some kind of cracked in looking apartments for sure. But it's kind of, I think anywhere you go, you make your home. And I actually like it when it rains here. It makes LA seem real again.
Makes it seem like England.
Yeah. I think in LA you just have to, like, I came here when I was 10 and it was nothing like the suburbs I'd grown up in. And you just kind of find your area of the city that you love. Some people love the beach, some people love Silver Lake. I love the valley. It's suburb to me, and so that's where I live.
It feels like a workplace to me, though. It always has. It feels like a place to be here and be like, I want to work.
Yeah.
Now I'm here, I'm going to get work.
Totally.
And then I'm going to go on vacation.
It's not very homey feeling.
Elgin, when you got all the characters started robbing the guys,
mm-hmm.
do you think there's a danger that the audience might not like any of the characters?
Yeah. Definitely, and that's what we worked on really a lot with all the actors. And that's where Juno was so great, because there were times where the producers were like, she's kind of really out there, but she needs to be likable. And Juno's just like so brave about it. It doesn't matter if anybody likes me. This is just who Lily is. I feel like all the characters kind of like, or all the actors kind of had to just go with that. And then there's some times where I was afraid that people would like the characters too much. Like you have Hogan, who's like the salt of the earth and this really strong character, but when he takes off his shirt, he's afraid of like, you know, there's a little too much around him, too much like this elevated character, so he's got like white power prison tattoos, you know, because he's had his past and he's come through kind of beaten up. But even with the men that come for the situation to start robbing people, it's important for me to be like, you're not a bad guy. You know, like you're doing something terrible, but you can't have an actor come to it like, oh, I'm terrible, I'm a pedophile, I'm this and this. You have to come at it with your own excuses, because I just did a year in prison, and I was the only guilty person in prison. You know what I mean? Everyone's done all these terrible things, but everyone's just like, well, they had it coming, or they feel justified. And, because I think that's true. When something happens to you, especially when you're younger, you feel like you're kind of like frozen there. Like if you're hurt when you're seven, you'll always, even if you're like a 37-year-old, you'll still always be that seven-year-old in the world that has it coming. So I feel like that was really important, and I wanted, even with the last character, J.R. Bourne, the villain J.R. Bourne, who comes in and turns our whole film upside down the last 15 minutes, but there's a situation where you're feeling really a lot of empathy for him, of like, don't go in here, don't go in there, then I have him say something really terrible, and then all of a sudden we're just like, maybe I don't like you, you know?
I want to ask the girl something about what you would do if you were a teenager in a really run-down place like that with no activities for anybody your age group. Would you read? You as a person, not your character, but what would you do? You want out, probably, or maybe not. You think it's pretty, so.
Well, I definitely paint. And, like, write. It's not obviously like poetry. I never read anybody, but I, it's like you've had some bit. I think, and I definitely read. And use your imagination. You know, anywhere you are, that even growing up in the beautiful rolling hills of Somerset where Byron writes his poetry, I had to use my imagination. I do not have a lot of people around me other than chickens and ponies. So you're there, and my father was amazing with that, and in Hans, he built me these hedges that got higher as you ran down them, so you felt like you were shrinking, so I was always in a rabbit hole.
Oh, cool.
Yeah, so your imagination goes wild in places like that, and you create these amazing scenarios, and you can turn a dirt mound into the most beautiful palace that anyone has ever been invited to, ever.
Okay.
You know?
Yeah,
well, I also
cool.
just think that, you know, you, when you grow up in one way, that's all you think of. I grew up in suburbs, that's how I thought the world is, and that's what you think everybody else grew up in, and so I think I would have loved it there, I think, had you been born and raised there. It's all you know, it's what you love. I probably would have.
Can I just quickly piggyback on the being in prison for a year and a half? You know, there's a certain programming your mind has when you're homeless and you're in prison. I'm so fascinated. How did you turn that around? How did you turn those inner voices around to success when you came from a background like that?
It was really hard. Also, just being from Boston, you always have this mantra in your head of like, you think you're better than me. You know what I mean? That's like such a Boston thing. That's why we hate New York so much. You know what I mean?
I'm a New Yorker, don't
you? See, that's it. Because you guys actually kind of are better than us. You know what I mean? But that was really hard for me to get past that. And that, again, that just comes with being mentored by incredible people.
So you know, it was your mentor?
It was my mentors. Like Robert Redford, Ed Harris, Walter Mosley, Catherine Hardwick. People that like took me under their wing and really showed, you had to break through that veneer. Especially with Robert Redford and Ed Harris were the first positive male role models I had. I mean, ridiculously that it was them, ridiculous that I was in my 30s, you know what I mean? But that was the first time I had men who were men, but were just like, you need to break down those walls, break through that shit, and draw that bullshit.
Yeah, because didn't you keep getting that playing in your mind, like, I'm a loser, this is
the totally, that's exactly
yeah,
right.
Yeah. And that's the biggest struggle
and
for
yeah,
some of
that's,
people.
And you're there and being around people and being like, you guys are all so much smarter than me, except with the Sundance Labs and all the other fellows that already made films and done all this stuff, and they really were, not a self-deprecating way, they were smarter than me. But I was like, I can either go back in my shell and retreat, or I'm going to try to be better. You know, I don't want to be ordinary, I want to try to be extraordinary, and you have to make yourself vulnerable. And then going to prison, you know, it's hard not to tap back into those same things. Like I said, it's like being a drunk in like a liquor store and trying not to drink. But then you come out and you have your friends and your loved ones, like I have with these two and the other people around me, that like bring you able to tap back into what's important, which is we're all going to die. And you want to leave a footprint on the world. Mm-hmm. And I left a really negative footprint, and now I want to leave like one that's much more honest and feeling. And that's one way to do that, is to make it art.
Now, Elgin, when you look back at the finished product, you know, obviously this is a project that's very close to your heart, are you completely satisfied with what you've put on screen? Is there anything you would change at all?
For one, because like, film is like this living organism and it changes every time with the audience, but just to watch these two and the performance that they give, I get lost in it every single time. So maybe there are technical things that I would change of like, oh, that's where I compromise a little bit. I'll let someone in my head, there's maybe like one or two things, but for the most part, what we have up there is more than I ever could have thought of. You know, I have this how I visioned it, and then these people came on with their own stuff, these two, and then it turned into something completely organic and beautiful. So now there's nothing I would change, except the truck.
Thanks, guys.
I need a shot for my website, keep shooting video.
Shoot a shot.
Kettles. Okay, yeah, you guys, whoa, that just went off. What is wrong with this thing?
My best friend Lily thought she was drowning. Drowning in the Salton Sea.
Get my six? He's come open now?
You need to talk to someone, kiddo. You need to. And you're surely not talking to me.
Does he have a boyfriend? Are you ever in LA?
I like him.
I know you do.
I figured it out. We're gonna take Hogan's truck to LA.
Where we live.
I have to go back.
What? No.